but it's better to have belief in yourself. It's great to have support, but it's better to have mental strength. It's great to have people in your corner, but it's better to be able to conquer. Good morning, dear students. This is Dr. Jyoti Badyal, Principal, Abhi Public School, Dharu. I'm very pleased and delighted to speak to all of you on such an auspicious day. Hope you all are equally excited for this event. Dear students, great moments are born from great opportunity. That's why you are here today. Out of great number of presenters, you are chosen to be here. It means you are best. You are the best. Believe in yourself. Dear budding stars, you aren't scared. You are courageous. You aren't weak. You are powerful. You aren't ordinary. You are remarkable. My lovely budding stars, just keep all your worries aside and give your best on the virtual platform. Dear children, no one can compete you. You can only compete because you are the best. Success and failure are the faces of a coin. You succeed or fail, it hardly matters. Even it doesn't matter, my dear lovely children, it doesn't matter. But what matters is your hard work, your belief in yourself, and ultimately your goal. In the last, I wish you all the very best for today's performance and pray to Almighty God to bestow all His finest blessings on you. Thank you. Jai Hind.
No, you are not audible, beta.
Ma'am, is it better now?
Yes, yes. Your time starts now.
Independence brought dreams of not just individual, but social, political, and economic freedom. 75 years later, the ideals have undergone a transformation, as the Industrial Revolution is another one of those extraordinary jumps forward in the story of civilization. It brings along a learning revolution. Good morning, distinguished members of the jury, respected teachers, and all my worthy opponents. I quote Team 1, P1, and glad to have gotten this opportunity to take a stand for the motion. So Cambridge historian Agnes Madison's work suggests that India's share of world income shrank from 22% in the 1700s, almost equal to Europe as a whole, to just 3% in the 1900s. And as frightening as these statistics are, they were acknowledged but never acted upon efficiently. It is thus no surprise that Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel said in a speech that economic regeneration would be the most crucial task of the new nationalist government. The state, represented by Jawaharlal Nehru, Subhash Chandra Bose, and Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, firmly believed that rapid industrialization would be the best antidote for mass poverty. But then, what changed our approach? After Sir Nehru's tenure, policy focus shifted from heavy industry to agriculture. These decisions were made more out of desperation rather than conviction. Oh, and then the leaders famously swung left in a bid to get communist support in their fights against the communist old guard. The petty politics and indecisiveness resulted in our policies becoming a victim of the apathy of our leadership. The choice was between economic populism and economic liberalism. Where has that left us? After nearly 50 years of what can only be deferred to as the biggest strategic blunder. Well, it has brought us nowhere near countries like China and United States in terms of industrial advancement. The flaws in this strategy have become increasingly evident. The industrial sector, which was supposed to work as the engine of growth, wasn't able to raise employment enough, employing only 23% of the total labor force while contributing 26% to the GDP. Whereas the primary sector, which employs 41% of the total labor force, only contributes 17 to 18%. About 52 million people in the primary sector are in disguised unemployment, the biggest amongst any other sectors. While 51 million people in the manufacturing industries alone account for nearly 17% of the Indian economy. Fascinating, isn't it? And although self-reliance, employment, and agricultural support go hand in hand, it is surprising that even today, the agricultural sector, which is undoubtedly an integral part of our society, the means of our subsistence, receives a budget of 16 lakh crores, while the backbone of our economy, the means of our progress, the industrial sector, only receives 2 lakh crores. And the truth is, industries don't just boost the economy. They've also played a pivotal role in the Green Revolution. So I fail to understand why an industrial revolution was never implemented at such a large scale. Why this stepmotherly treatment? There is no better investment than investing in ourselves. By doing that 70 years ago, the heights we could have reached are unprecedented. Heading towards the end, I urge everyone present here today to make good on the promise that was made years ago. The twist with our destiny, we shall redeem our pledge. At the stroke of the midnight hour, when the world sleeps, India will awake to life and freedom. And now, to rapid growth and development. Thank you.
Thank you so much, participant one of team one, for throwing light on the topic and providing us with the insights of the need to focus on industries and employment after India gained independence. This indeed is a great start to the competition. Now I request the interjected one to put forward the question to participant one of team one. Is the interjected one ready?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so you can put forward your question.
First of all, I to appreciate your views. But for your kind information, I want to tell you that in the past, more than half of the population faced serious hunger. If India hadn't focused on agriculture, most of the population would have starved to death. You just tell me one thing, if our population hadn't survived, who would have run the industries? Their dead bodies or hypocrites? Well, this is impossible.
Thank you for your question, sir. And I would like to inform you that I do agree with you that India was short in food supplies. But what you might not know is that the PL480 scheme of USA was basically given to India, which provided them with enough food supplies for us to focus on our industrial reforms, as was done in the second five-yearly plan and the third five-yearly plan. And industries don't just boost employment, they also boost our agriculture. For example, the chemical industry provides us with fertilizers, manures, and pesticides, which also boost our agricultural grains and support. Thank you.
Well, you tried well to make your phantasm real. Thanks for your answer, my friend.
That was indeed a fascinating sight to look at. I must apprise you all that the participants present over here are the bravest right now, as one of the most difficult things considered in the world is public speaking. I congratulate you all for reaching this milestone in your long journey. Thank you so much, participants. Now, without any further ado, I invite participant number two from team one on this virtual platform to share the views against the motion. I hope the participant is ready.
Yes, ma'am.
All right, your time starts now.
Ma'am, just a second.
All right, yes, you're audible.
Ma'am, the time bell was not audible for P1. So if you could increase the volume for that.
Okay. Right, just a minute. Is it audible? Okay. Your time starts now.
Would you commit a crime for cow dung? 800 kgs of cow dung was stolen from Dhurena village, Chhattisgarh, after the state government had declared to procure it at 2 rupees per kg. Vikas, initially arrested for stealing manure from the local administration, was arrested again. for attempting suicide. His desperation was such that he wanted to get shot by the police, seeing no hope, and had already lost his land to the bank. Good morning, everyone, honorable members of the jury, and my fellow participants. I, OT1, am here to expose the duality, irrationality, and utter dissonance to facts of my opponents and present my ardent support to the arguments against the motion. Ghaziabad, a district in UP famous for sugarcane, has 2 years of groundwater left. Apple orchid owners in Himachal are protesting for being offered low prices for their produce, while Apple seem to be out of mandis as if harvested by Steve Jobs. Many such stories can be found in each state, each district of India. Can this be described as the state of a sector undergoing rapid reforms since 1947? Amidst all this, I find it extremely hard to comprehend as to how can well-educated students agree that a vast population devoid of bread be encouraged to produce bedsheets and bicycles. Bajaj, Mahindra, Godrej, Dabur are all market leaders in the Indian manufacturing sector, while farmers from the reformed agricultural sector burns himself for inability of paying debt. One cannot undermine the rapid progress in the primary sector after the Green Revolution or the fourth five-year plan per se, but it helped India reach subsistence at the cost of the quality of the grain produced and provided nothing more than that. The same adocism and the same nearsightedness for agriculture has remained constant across governments, leading to late and insufficient reforms for mere subsistence. The general progression of the progress in any economy starts from the primary sector and progresses subsequently. Putting agro reforms as a priority would benefit the 60% of population, which later amounted for 54% of the GDP. Putting money in their hands to generate demand in Indian markets would not just lead to greater levels, to higher levels of consumption and better standards of living. This boom would suffice to balance the initial lack of funding for industries. Creating agro-centric irrigation and transport facilities would not just reform agriculture, it would provide basic infrastructure for masses. Agricultural reforms would kickstart India's economy and push it in a virtuous cycle of progress and prosperity. If the state would have focused on agricultural reform instead of industries, the heart-wrenching stories of farmer suicides and people dying of hunger would have foregone long ago. The paradox of agriculture, where farmers are de-stressed because of low selling prices and consumers harassed for high prices, reminds us that water reforms, land reforms, privatization of the economy are great prerogatives, but are not agricultural reforms. Agricultural reforms are for every person who eats. Any freedom without any independence, without the independence of food, is futile. So I would solemnly state, letting the base of our economy and society rot in pre-colonial era cannot put us at the center stage of the world. It cannot make us worthy enough for the position we had or aspire for. Thank you.
Very well said, participant number 2 from team 1. Participants, I know that the past few days, rather weeks, would have been tough for you, not wanting to give yourself even a single chance to be less prepared. All your hard work over the days and those sleepless nights have proved their worth when you see yourself as part of this Nadan Kamat Inter-APS English Debate Competition. So let's go with the flow, and I call upon the interjector 1 to put forward the question again to participant number 2 from team 1. Is the interjector ready?
Yes, ma'am.
You can put forward your question.
First of all, I really appreciate you. But you just tell me one simple thing, that must be fun of focusing on agrarian reforms for more than 75 years, if still more than 10,000 farmers suicide every year. Also more than 190 million people go to bed without food every day. And also out of that, more than 7,000 died because of hunger. So what's the fun of focusing on agriculture in 75 years of independence. We still are here at that position.
Thank you for the question, fellow participant. I would like to state that since that you are saying that we are undertaking agricultural reform for the last 75 years, my friend, the fact that the statistic you stated for farmer suicide, I would like to tell you, we have not collected any data for farmer suicide since 2016. Is that how you undertake reforms? By denying data? By not collecting data? My whole point is that the agricultural reforms we undertook were not connected to the ground. They were not connected to the soil. We only took implements and models from different nations and applied them to India. We over-relied on the PL480 scheme from America. And just to continue that, we imported the fertilizers and the new technologies which America asked us to do. Why? Because they are the ones selling those equipment. They are the only ones who are the big producers of that equipment in the whole world. They wanted to sell us their produce and get rid of their free grain. We did that. Revolutions are not imposed on people. They start from the ground. Revolutions are not imposed by other states on different countries. Agricultural reform was never a priority for us and still isn't. Thank you.
Well, I think you didn't listen to my question. I asked you about this current status, the current statistical information. Okay, well, you tried well to make your phantasm real, but it doesn't make sense. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, both the participants, for such a healthy discussion. Each one of you are excelling in each bit of opportunities that you all have got. And this is the most amazing thing that we all are witnessing here today. There is a definite sense of coherence and linkage that you all are talking about. So here I invite the next participant number one from team two, to portray the views on the given topic. I hope you're ready.
Yes, am I audible?
Yes, you're audible. Okay, your time starts now.
Atmanirbhar Bharat, the new slogan for the new India. Why did it take 3/4 of a century for this country to finally start focusing on industry? Why did China become a $10 trillion economy while we are struggling to reach $5 trillion, even when we had similar GDP sizes in 1978? Even after focusing so much on agriculture, why is India I'm glad we are finally trying to be Atmanirbhar, because historically we have missed out on a lot of Atmanirbharta. Good morning, everyone. This is Raghav, and I'm going to speak in favor of the motion. Sure, agriculture is very important. How else are we going to eat? But it is not the end all be all for modern economies. We are not living in the Neolithic era. This is the 21st century, where major economies focus on services and industries. My opponents remind me of physiocrats from the 18th century, who believed that a nation's wealth was solely derived from the value of land agriculture. But again, we are living in the 21st century. Raj Krishna, a popular economist, once said, and I quote, "The technical linkages between agriculture and industry are such that even a 4% rate of growth in agriculture is not possible without a high rate of growth in industries which supply the input requirements for a growing agriculture." It's not like we never focused on industries. In 1950s, there was a good amount of focus on the heavy goods sector. And it is this focus that gave us the Steel Authority of India Limited, Oil Corporation of India Limited, ONGC, and other PSUs. But it was not enough. And it was all downhill from there till the new economic policy of 1990s. In 1978, the Chinese GDP was $293.6 billion in comparison to India's $293.2 billion. Since then, the gap between the two GDPs has exploded. In 2018, the Chinese GDP was $10.8 trillion and the Indian GDP was only $2.85 trillion. The reason for this significant difference in the GDP is that China announced an open door policy for foreign businesses wanting to set up shops in China, and it became a factory for the world. Meanwhile, India hung on to the policy of import substitution for an inordinately long period of time, and in the process could never develop the ability to produce quality products that could compete in the international market. Before independence, the British rule had led to deliberate deindustrialization of India, because of which a country's per capita income fell, leading to large-scale unemployment. After independence, it was the need of the hour to focus on reviving India's traditional industries and large-scale capacity building for the manufacturing sector. Due to these deficiencies, the Indian labor moved directly from agriculture to the services sector, leaving us with an underdeveloped industrial sector. Ladies and gentlemen, a lot should have been done. A lot can be done. And fortunately, now a lot is being done. Hopefully, with programs like Make in India, Skill India, and Atmanirbhar Bharat, India can develop industry further. And who knows, even become the new manufacturing hub of the world. Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing such wonderful perspective. Sometimes you say what you got to say because you are in a debate. But here we are witnessing that you all appear to be believing in what to say, what you are saying. And that's the most remarkable thing, displaying conviction in whatever you are saying. I now request interjector two to put across the question to participant one of team two. Is the interjector ready?
Am I audible?
I think your volume is little low.
Am I audible now? Is it better?
Yes, it's better. Is the participant able to hear the interjector? Participant, are you able to hear the interjector?
Yes, for now I'm able to. Let her speak, please.
The worthy speaker being of the opinion that India should have focused on industrialization post-independence, even asking why we took the amount of time that we did to get around to industrialization. However, I'd like to point out that India was a young country. About 75 years ago, we lacked the necessary capital, know-how, and even a ready market. While competing against countries like the US and countries in Western Europe, which is not only established in the field, but also industrialized. So my question to the worthy speaker is, could we really have succeeded in industrialization when we were still facing such circumstances?
Yeah, thank you for the question, and it's a good question, I must say. What I want to make you understand, that definitely in the beginning, India did focus somewhat on industries, as I already told in my debate, and the people were criticizing this, and then India shifted to focus on agriculture more. But the thing they should have kept in the mind is that they should have also side-by-side focused on the industries, because we could not completely rely on agriculture only. The condition of USA was slightly different, because the people, they were a bit more developed as compared to India at that time. And the thing which I want to tell you here, that agriculture is, the people think that agriculture is a solution of our problems, but it is not true, because we are not living in an ideal world. Here, agriculture can fluctuate very much. And the reason is that it depends on monsoon, fertilizers, HYV seeds. We could import the HYV seeds, but we could not import the monsoon. And that is the reason we face so many famines. This is the reason that we should focus on industrial sector so that we can have another sector on which we can depend upon for the GDP, and we can use it for the time of crisis. I hope it would suffice. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for the answer, sir. However, I do believe that you misunderstood my question. Thank you.
Thank you so much, both the participants. Very well articulated response. As we move ahead, I'm sure that the participants are giving a tough time to our judges as they are presenting such wonderful speaking skills, creating challenges for our judges. So let's call upon our next participant on this virtual debating platform, participant number two from team two. I hope you're ready.
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible. So your time starts now.
A farmer is the only man in an economy who buys everything at retail, sells everything at wholesale, and pays the freight both ways. Good morning, Honorable Chairperson, respected principals, teachers, and my fellow competitors. Today, I'll be speaking against the motion. The Agrarian Reform Program has been justified for two main reasons. The first is to create greater efficiency in agriculture production in terms of land size. And this is based on the notion that smaller size farms, due to agrarian reforms, are much more productive than the larger size farms. Although our world continues to urbanize at an alarming rate, with PwC estimating nearly 1.5 million new people becoming the part of this metropolitan population every week. And there is no getting away from the fact that agrarian activities will always be necessary in future. And that's no bad thing, aside from the simple fact that till we need to eat, agriculture remains and plays a crucial role in economies and societies all around the world for countless countries in tackling climate change, for food security, for abolishing food security, ending hunger, and much more. Indeed, its role is no more pronounced than in Asia's second most populated country, India. Despite rapid urban growth, nearly two-thirds of our country's population is still dependent on agriculture and continues to live in remote areas. And it is the largest part of the reason why past 50 years has seen a dramatic improvement in national output. When the first five-year plan was launched in 1950, agriculture was given priority. Nehru, while addressing both the houses of parliament in November 1952, said, "We certainly attach importance to industry, but in the present context, we attach far greatest importance to agriculture, food, and matters pertaining agriculture. And if our agriculture foundation is not strong, then our industry will not seek to have a stronger base either. Whereas, if our agriculture becomes strongly entrenched, as we hope it will, then there will be no getting away from the fact that we would be easier to progress on industrial front. Whereas, if we focus on industries and leave agriculture in a weakening condition, we shall ultimately be the weakening industry. And remember that agriculture was the first occupation of man and the foundation of all other industries. The production of food grains increased from 51 million tons in 1950 to 1951 to 283 million tons in 2018 to 2019. And these figures are undeniably impressive. That makes us more remunerative and attractive for younger generations. As a result, India has been able to transition from food aid dependent country to the net exporter of its own produce. And all this happened owing to our first prime minister and our government, as at the time they had to prioritize between agriculture and industries, and they choose agriculture. And then Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru said, "Everything else can wait, but not agriculture." And we all know agriculture is one of the most powerful tools in ending all these diseases and in chronic malnutrition, poverty, hunger, and much more. And it is well documented that growth in agriculture sector is much more helpful in reducing poverty than growth in any other sector. For this reason, we are now trying to find a bigger, better, and a faster solution for ending all these crises. As agriculture gives us sustainable development, sustainable environment, food, that is wholesome, equal to better future, that is full of employment. The sun is beating on your back, forces the moisture from your bones into the earth you call your own. You are a farmer, and agriculture is a nation's backbone. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the wonderful performance. I'm sure all of you are having a great time over here as all the teams are debating and giving their best to win. So may the best team win today. So on this call, I invite Interjector 2 again to interject Participant 2 from Team 2. So Interjector 2, are you ready?
Yes, ma'am. So you mentioned that agriculture was the first employment opportunity conceived by man. However, I'd like to point out that countries who employed the majority of the workforce in the agricultural sector also happen to be one of the most poorly developed nations in the world. Countries like Niger and Chad being examples of those. So I would like to ask the worthy speaker, isn't this a clear example? Isn't this a clear indicator that if generating employment opportunities via industrial development would be a much better and a more viable option?
Well, thank you for your question. And the answer of your question lies in my speech. As I quoted, agriculture foundation is much necessary for industries. If our agriculture foundation is not strong, then our industry will not seek to have a stronger base either. As at the time of independence, there were refuges, poverty, hunger, scarcity of food and land everywhere. And if our money we would spend on all industries that much people are not aware about, how would we feed our 80% of the population that are dependent on agriculture? And much more easier, and it would be much more easier to invest on agriculture that more people are indulged in and are specialized. And if we focus on industries rather than focusing on agriculture, we shall ultimately face many consequences. Like we don't have investment to add in our industries, and much more. People don't know how to run an industry. Well, thank you.
Thank you so much for the answer, ma'am.
Thank you so much, participants, for such an excellent discussion. That was a display of absolutely amazing combat. I don't think there is a one winner here. All the voices that we have heard are truly a boon to the schools. And dear participants, all of you can be the future torchbearers of putting forward the opinions. So now it's time to witness the wonderful thoughts of next participant. I would like to invite participant number one from team three. Are you ready?
Yes, I'm audible.
Okay, your time starts now.
Good morning, all. Today I'm here to speak for the motion. If we talk about post-independence, then the agriculture sector was dominating our country. About 75% of the population was dependent on agriculture. But for any economy to be globally successful, it must have a robust industrial sector. I'll tell you why, and for that, I'll take you back to the era after independence. The agriculture development was focused by our government right from the first 5-year plans. Later on, many policies also came into plans, but nothing seemed to solve the massive problem of our country, unemployment and poverty. With the rise in economy of any country, the factors which are important are growth, modernization, and self-reliance. But the development of agriculture alone could not cater these factors. There were a lot of problems faced by the agriculture sector. Low productivity. It happened because of the lack of knowledge of farmers, and it forced India to import food from USA. Disguised employment. It refers to a state in which people are highly engaged in work than required, overpopulating the sector, and thus resulting in less income. High dependency on rainfall also resulted in minimum income in this sector in the year it received less or over rainfall. Ultimately, reliance on only agriculture had led us to poverty. What was the solution? I feel it was industrialization. What is industrialization? It is the building and growing of industries within an economy. In simple words, transferring human growth from agrarian society to industrial society. But what benefits could the industries provide to the nation? I'll explain. Stability. Industries provide employment, which is much more stable than the employment in agriculture. How? If you practically see, labor is only required during sowing, harvesting, when the fertilizers are sprayed, and sometimes to remove weed. Labor is not required round the year, which again leads to unemployment and instability. But in industries, there is more stability as industries hire people as per contract and work is available throughout the year. It decreases the per capita income. A person can earn more in the industrial sector as an individual earns on daily basis. It provides varied avenues for employment for skilled laborers. We can develop industries in all sectors like shipping, textiles, automobiles, defense manufacturing, and so on. Industries enable diversification of markets. It boosts the economy of other sectors, including the agriculture sector. It also helps in earning foreign exchange. How? We produce goods, export them, in return, we get money. Nation becomes self-reliant if it manufactures indigenously. For instance, we are still heavily dependent on Russia and other European countries for our weapons and their ammunition. What if, in the future, we are in a state of war with those same countries? If we critically analyze the benefits of the industrial sector, over and again, we see that the agriculture sector could not absorb the entire population in their employment requirements. I feel industrialization was the solution to break this vicious cycle of poverty, increase our economy, and become a self-reliant nation. If India were to focus on industries besides the Nagarjuna reforms, then the outcome would have been quite different. India would have been a much more developed and proficient country. Thank you.
Very well said. As education is the passport to the future, for tomorrow belongs to those who prepare for it today. And we all can see very well how prepared our participants are today. So without any further delay, I invite interjector 3 to put forward the question to participant 1 from team 3. Is the interjector ready?
Yes. Yes, I will be hearing.
Yes, you are audible. You can put forward your question.
Okay. Thank you for giving us vision regarding the topic. Dear friend, keeping thoughtfully your point in which you said that role of employment, the manufacturing sector has a huge role in giving employment and economic growth and all that what you said. Right? So in that context, I would like to ask, suppose you are a very high position holder of your country, a country in which people are dying of starvation, a country which is facing food shortages like that of 1960s and 1970s of India, like that of Bengal famine, like that of Bihar famine. What would you as a leader have done in this context? Would you have chosen for industrialization, which cannot feed your people, or you would have chosen for agrarian reform to feed your people, since food is the basic necessity of any living being?
Thank you, my dear friend, for the question, but I don't agree with you. You see, in my speech, I earlier mentioned a term called disguising work. It means that people are highly engaged in work than the actual requirement, which results in overpopulation of the sector and also results in less income. So what I would have done, that even when the agriculture sector was dominating our country, there was still poverty. And I would have chosen the industrialization, because industries provide employment which is much more stable. Why? Because industries are much more stable than agriculture. Thank you.
I would like to say that I gave you a situation in which you were the leader, and you have to say, and the situation was that your country is under a pyramid of food scarcity. So employment or all these things comes after food. So I think the giving answer should be based on food rather than employment. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, both the participants, for such a great discussion. I'm sure that this indeed is a very proud moment for not only you participants, but for your principals and teachers, as you all must have undergone the screening process to reach this level. To see you all debating with such beautiful confidence is absolutely wonderful. So without any further delay, I request our next participant from team 3 to take over the virtual platform. That is participant number 2 from team 3. Are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
Yes, you're audible. Okay, so your time starts now.
The best quality.
5 minutes.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am participant 2, representing Team 3, debating on the topic, after independence, India should have focused on industries and employment rather than focusing on agrarian reforms. But today, I consider myself as an ambassador protecting the decision taken decades ago regarding agrarian reforms. And in that capacity, I'd like to introduce the topic first. Well, the history of independent India began when the country became an independent nation. Direct administration by the British, which I believe started in 1858, affected the economic and political unification of the subcontinent. Agriculture plays an important, a credential role in the process of economic development of less developed countries like India. Best providing food to the nation, agriculture releases labor contributes to the market of industrial goods and earns foreign exchange. Agriculture and allied activities contribute nearly 50% to the nation's total economic development. Around 72% of the total marketing population was engaged with agriculture. Moreover, 80% of the people were more familiar with agriculture. British hired cheap labor, came to our country, took our resources, and exported it to their country to save money. I mean, astonishing, astonishing, the world's most developed country who was taking over, the world's most technologically forward people came to our country to use our resources. Well, they didn't really have to save money, the Ambanis of the world, but my point here is, we have the resources. Why wouldn't we advertise to create capital and bring ourselves a stable state of economy? Which brings me to the agrarian reforms, by the way. But first, I'd like to emphasize, why were these reforms created? After British came, land became property. Farmers became poor and food insecurity grew. India became a village-based agriculture system. Deurbanization and deindustrialization created a great pressure on agriculture. Now, coming back to the agrarian reforms, the first one was abolition of intermediaries. It was followed by tenancy reforms, which provided security to the tenants. The abolition of zamindari system made almost 2 crore tenants the owner of the lands they cultivated. I repeat, the abolition of the zamindari system made almost 2 crore tenants the owners of the land they cultivated. It was followed by ceilings of land holdings and consolidation of land holdings. After independence, India's industrial sector was very poor, contributing only 11.8% to the nation's GDP. The output and productivity were very low, and we were technologically backward whatsoever. To support this sector, we needed people who were familiar with it as well as the resources. But we, on the other hand, had neither of them. To conclude, India was a very exploited and exhausted country after the suppression of British. I urge you all to not fuel the arguments of the people debating against a decision taken decades ago, as today as well, the data for distribution of workforce across all the sectors still shows that agriculture is the largest contributor to economy, with 42.6% followed by the other two sectors. I beg to propose this motion tonight. Thank you very much, Bill.
Well, very well said. Competition creates a lot of pressure. The demands can be overwhelming, but this is your chance to prove yourself, to prove what you are worth, to show what you can offer. Don't feel threatened by others who you think might be better than you. Instead, be proud that you are among them. For winning means fighting with all what you have got, but with your dignity intact. So on this note, I request the interjector 3 to put forward the question to participant 2 of team 3. Is the interjector ready?
Yes, am I here?
Yes, you may put forward your question.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me such a nice speech. But I would like to question that, dear friend, keeping your thought very strongly and very powerfully, you said that one of the things you said that about agrarian reform was green revolution, right? Green revolution was based on HYB seeds, technology, fertilizers, and all that, right? I want and the thing which is should be underlined that India exported all these things from other countries, from fertilizers to technology to HYB seeds. My question is, if we would have given much focus on manufacturing sector rather than agrarian reforms, we would be self-sufficient in all these things. And imposition or implementation of green revolution would be far better. What do you think about it?
Okay, so thank you so much for your question. So the industrial development prior to the 5-year plans was largely based on consumer-based goods sectors. So the industries like cotton, jute, or iron were very amazing industries, were producing very good outputs, but the other industries were producing none of the outputs. So we can't cherry pick only certain industries and say we can be self-employed after that, right? We can't cherry pick only those two industries. And do you
Did you actually question yourself one time that why were the agrarian reforms created? Because British exploited the agricultural economy so much. They came here for their selfish reasons. They exploited it so much. That's why India felt the need to propose these agrarian reforms. Okay, I'll give you an example. Gold and silver. I choose gold over silver. But at that time, if I don't earn enough, my choices won't affect. If I'm earning a certain amount, I have to be sufficient with silver. That's what India did. 80% of the people were more familiar with agriculture. That's why the government focused on agrarian reforms, so it could create not a stable, but a state of economy. We only lay one brick at a time, right? And no one sees the whole house when that brick is laid. That brick is very important. Let me tell you, it's very important. At last, I just said to her, India was surely a very slow walker, but it was not a back walker. I hope you got my point. Even if you didn't, I think I put my point forward quite strongly. Thank you.
Thank you. But I asked about the manufacturing sector, the development of fertilizers and technology sector. You talked about textile industry, but that's okay. Thank you so much.
Great discussion. Thank you so much, both the participants. That was a wonderful combat to look at. Debates in the modern times are not won by the person who knows the most information. They are won by the people who are most persuasive for and show conviction in their opinions. So pull your socks and display the conviction. So with this, I request the next participant to be ready. And our next participant is participant number one from team four. I hope you're ready.
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
I'll start.
Your time starts now.
Once Allah Mulari well said that no country in this world can ever be successful in the long term without a really strong and vibrant manufacturing and economic base. A raging battle with this COVID-19 is still on. This virus has brought the world to its knees with two massive implications, loss of life and the loss of livelihood. A very warm good morning to honorable chief guests, worthy teachers and the future builders of India. Today, I am here to debate for the motion on the given topic. There's a reason why I started with this COVID-19. The past 2 years have been the evidence of the resentment being planned against China. In such tough situations, the world is seeing India as the replacement of China in terms of industrial goods and services. And remember, this could be possible only because of industrialization. Now, I'll be presenting some statistics which will make you all believe that if industrialization was brought prior to India, what impacts could it have? Firstly, it won't lead to the brain drain, and the brightest minds of the nation could be deployed in various sectors. Secondly, the brightest minds of the nation could be deployed in developing new items from IT sector to medical sector, making the people of the world to buy things from India and making India one of the biggest and the richest exporters all around the world. Thirdly, if industrialization was brought prior to India, then it might happen that the Indian rupee be having much more value than the US dollars and the Silicon Valley be born in India rather than California. Fourthly, as we all know, the maximum population of India is those of agriculture. So they tend to live in poverty because they work in a low productive sector of agriculture and receive low salaries. If industrialization was brought prior, then it might happen that those people need not to live in poverty for generations, as industrialization gives employment opportunities. Now, if we just assume a crowd of people, I am sure that the maximum in them would be dreaming of settling in USA and UK. Why? Because those countries have the employment opportunities that we don't have. We have to make our nation much capable that the people from all around the world come to India to get settled, rather than we, the Indians, migrating to to various parts of the world to get settled. You know, India has a population of 229 million youth, out of which only 23% youth is engaged in industries. So how will India develop further? Now, if we just talk about agricultural sector and farmers, what do we have in the news nowadays? Farmers are starving, farmers are suiciding, farmers on a strike, farmers this, that, etc. The reason is farmers nowadays are in a pathetic condition because they don't have much money to feed their families. I don't mean that India is not progressing, but this progress could be achieved a few decades before with industrialization. At last, I would like to conclude with a quote that in every sector, whether big or small, it is the industries that support us all. Thank you.
Well, very well articulated thoughts. It is well said that you don't win a debate by suppressing discussion. You win it with a better argument. And there are no tough opponents in a debate, but only tough issues. Moving ahead, so let's call our interjector 4 to put forward the question to the participant 1 of team 4. Is the interjector ready?
Yes, I'm audible.
Yes, you are absolutely audible. You can put forward your question.
First of all, greetings to the jury. I am very fortunate that I got a chance to speak on this platform. Friend, I listened to your arguments very well and also got a lot of knowledge. But a question is popping up in my mind. As you argued that there is a huge relation between the industries and employment, but you are aware of the fact that industries are leading to automation of jobs and thus increasing unemployment and layoff. What is your take on this?
Sorry to interrupt, but actually he is not clearly audible and I am not able to get the question clearly. Will you please repeat, my fellow mate?
Yeah, no problem. As you said, as you argued that there is a huge relation between employment and industry, you are saying this when you are aware of the fact that industries are leading to the automation of the jobs and thus increasing unemployment and leading to layoffs. What is your take on this?
As you said very well, that I am in favor that industries improve the employment opportunities. But the thing is that if you talk about agricultural sector, in agriculture, we have India. If you talk about our nation, India, India is filled with skilled manpower. So why to deploy it in low productive sectors of agriculture? What is productive in agriculture nowadays? I don't feel anything. But if industries, people have the caliber to work on industries and develop India as a very big and the brightest industrial nation in the world. So why not to deploy the manpower on that? And why not to work on employment services in terms of industries? And why to go towards agrarian development? Thank you.
Thank you for the answer, but I think you didn't hear my question. It was related to job automation. Well, thank you.
Thank you so much, both the participants. Speech is power. Speech is to persuade, to convert, to compel, and the function of leadership is to produce more leaders. And the way all of you are performing, we can see our future leaders. Let's call upon our next participant, participant number 2 from team 4. Are you ready?
Yeah. A very good morning.
Time starts now.
A very good morning, honorable chief guest, respected teachers and fellow youth who have the power to shape the future of the country. Today, I'll be speaking against the motion on the given topic. I would like to begin with a seemingly forgotten but very important slogan. Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan. Praise the soldier, praise the farmer. Throughout this, men from different parts of the world have invaded India and destroyed it to no end. The Britishers came under the grab of greed to our country, one of the richest in the world at that time. And after 200 years of plunder, they left it to be one of the poorest. Now all this talk of there should have been focused on industries and employment rather than a green reform. It's just so misinformed. At the time of independence, we were among the poorest countries in the world, ravaged by famines after famines. which meant we didn't even have food to eat. Then how would anyone in their right mind think about industrialization? How? Between the years 1943 and 1966, more than 3 million people died due to starvation, and all because of a famed Prime Minister of Britain who didn't consider Indians as humans, and 30 lakh died. Obviously, after such dreadful memories of death and plunder, the first thing that we wanted was food, and we chose the best option that we had, agriculture. In just 70 years, the Indian economy is larger than the UK and the fifth largest in the world. But if we didn't have food to eat, we would have never ever reached here. This is why agriculture and agrarian reforms were far more important than anything else at that time. Today, India can feed itself and sell the surplus to the world, adding to our economy. We are the world's largest producer of milk, pulses and spices, and are the world's largest producer, has the largest cattle herd, as well as the largest area under wheat, rice and cotton cultivation. I believe today's debate also has a deep-rooted bias against agriculture. Farmers and farming are generally considered to be backward just because of a missing tag of English-speaking population among the farmers in general. We consider only those people as superior who are educated in English. What a lousy byproduct of our slavery to the agriculture ranks second worldwide. Contribution of agriculture and related sectors in the year 1950 was about 51.9% to the GDP, whereas the contribution of industries accounted for just about 11.1%. Unknown to many, India's international trade in agriculture reforms were highly beneficial for the farmer beneficiaries. With this, I believe that my opponents will be convinced that whatever agrarian reforms took place at the time of independence were necessary and were crucial for future economic development in India. At last, I'd like to conclude with a quote. Industrialization
very well performed, articulated thoughts. The debate and divergence of views can only enrich our history and culture, and there are no secrets to success. It is the result of preparation and hard work which all of you are displaying today on this virtual platform. So let's go with the flow, and I invite our interjector board again to put forward the question. Is the interjector ready?
Yes, ma'am. I'm ready. Am I audible?
Yes, you may put forward your question.
Well spoke, but my question to the worthy speaker is, the problem of brain drain in India is on rise. Don't you think it's just because we don't have enough employment, because we never invested properly in our industrial sector?
I request the participant number 2 from team 4 to answer the question. Was the question audible to you?
No, the question was not audible, sorry.
Okay, can I request interjector 4 to again repeat the question.
My question to the worthy speaker is, the problem of brain drain in India is on rise. Don't you think it's just because we don't have enough employment, because we never invested properly in our industrial sector? What is your take on this?
Sorry, you are not audible. Still not audible.
I'll request the interjector four to kindly speak little loudly so that your question is audible to the participant. And I think team four, you need to check on your network because in between your video was also paused. So kindly check your network issue because...
Sorry ma'am, but you are audible, but the person, the interjector is not audible.
Okay, but I'm telling you about the glitch. So glitch that we saw was in your internet connection. So, okay, I request interjector four to again speak.
My question to the worthy speaker is, the problem of brain drain in India is on rise. Don't you think it's just because we don't have enough employment, because we never invested properly in our industrial sector? What is your take on this?
Talking about the employment, I'm very privileged to answer this question. Beginning with, let me tell you, at the beginning of our independence, in the 1950s, in India, more than 70% of the population were engaged in agriculture. How could you have focused on industries where just 20% of the population was engaged? You had to focus on the people, more people who are there in the agriculture. We had to bring those reforms to the agriculture because we had to feed our people. We could not leave our people just like that in China. We had to feed them. And for that, we required a strong agricultural base. For the industries, industries could have brought the employment, but how could you have brought industries prior to the agriculture? If you don't have a strong base, you can't build a strong building upon that. Let me tell you that. Now, employment. You could have brought the employment, but how could you have brought the employment without feeding your people? People were dying. You were hungry. They did not have the food. How could you have brought industries to your country? It was not practically possible. It is just an utopian vision of something. You think that it is perfect, but it is not practically possible. The situations in the 1950s were very deadly. More than 3 million people died. How could you have focused on industries? Thank you.
Thank you, my friend, but my question was related to brain drain and I don't think the question, the answer was even satisfactory. Well, thank you.
Thank you so much, both the participants. That was a very well articulated combat and we all know that public speaking is the art of giving power to words to influence, inspire and transform lives. So in order to witness another spell of powerful public speaking, I invite participant number one from team five. Are you ready?
Yes, ma'am. Just wanted to ask whether I'm clearly audible and visible.
Yes, you're audible. Your time starts now.
Industrial Revolution was another of those extraordinary jumps forward in the story of civilization. Good morning. Today I'm here from team five for the motion after independence. India should have focused on industries rather than focusing on agrarian reforms. Industrialization is the transformation of a society from primarily agrarian-based economy to mass-produced and technologically advanced goods and services. This phase is characterized by exponential leap in productivity and increased standards of living. Like two faces of coins, agriculture and industries, both are important, but what is the difference between our ancestors and us? Our ancestors were fully dependent on agriculture, had very less scope of comfort, all due to lack of industries. Working in agrarian life often involved working as long as the sun was up, only stopping because there was no light. Children were expected to begin at a very young age. However, productivity was chronically low. All this changed after industrialization. Today, we can communicate with anyone. All sort of comfort is present before us because of industries. Post-independence, India adopted agrarian reforms. But let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, in most part of the country, like Bihar and Orissa, the intermediaries were able to resume land under self-cultivation. By 1992, the total tenant land holding declined to 11%. Despite several bouts of legislation during 60s and 70s, all attempts regarding land ceiling and land redistribution failed miserably. There was a phenomenal increase in the number and the proportion of landless laborers.
I ask, was that a good proposition for the emerging Indian economy? This is where industrialization steps in. Through concerted program of industrialization, our nation can provide basis for growth and labor productivity. Industrialization brings about a favorable change in a country's occupational pattern. Agriculture is highly overcrowded. Industrialization creates the only way of employment generation. Even after reorganizing agriculture, one cannot expect to absorb large number of laborers in it. In this circumstance, the planners should have given correct emphasis on industrialization. No one can deny the interrelationship between agriculture and industries. Agricultural development is highly conditioned on industrial development. As industrialization proceeds, the demand for the usage goods, cash crops increases, the market expands. Thus, industries provide a climate conducive to agricultural development. Post-independence, India was moving towards globalization. The competition was increasing, which required increase in national income as well. Industries allow nations to make optimum use of their resources, increase the quality and the quantity of the goods manufactured. Industries provide economic stability, stimulate progress in other sectors as well. Due to increased employment generation, there is specialization of labor, larger scope for technological progress. In all, it leads to lesser pressure on land. Finally, after independence, India did not have many friends. And for security consideration, one cannot ignore the role of industries in the economy. Dependence on different countries for defense materials is a dangerous and a risky proposition. Thus, all sort of defense materials must be produced domestically. Self-sufficiency in defense materials can be only achieved through industrial development. Thus, I would like to conclude by saying that India was and is still a developing nation. And the transformation of a nation from developing to developed is marked by a move from the traditional sector, that is agriculture, to the modern sector. Hence, India should have focused on industries. Thank you.
That was absolutely amazing. No sentence can be effective if it contains facts only. It must also contain emotion, image, logic, and promise. And on this note, I call the next interjector, that is interjector number 5, to proffer the question. So is the interjector 5 ready?
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible?
Absolutely. Clearly, you are audible. You can go ahead with your question.
At the time of independence, India had a massive population of 340 million people. And one of the basic amenities that a human needs is food. And to fulfill this basic need, India focused heavily on agriculture during its first 2 5-year plans. This also gave the Indian industries a much needed boost by providing them a market for new machinery. Well, after keeping all these points and advantages in mind, don't you believe that our forefathers were right about focusing on agriculture first? And don't you believe that by focusing on agriculture, it has provided us with food security and an end to a recurrent cycle of famines in India? What are your thoughts on it?
Thank you, my dear friend. Thank you for not just asking the question, but actually strengthening my belief in the power of industrial revolution. Because I think you didn't listen to my speech carefully. If in case you would have not asked this question. Let me tell you, I clearly mentioned that soon after independence, India was moving towards globalization. The competition was increasing, which required increase in national income as well. Industries allow nations to make optimum use of their resources, increase the quality and the quantity of the goods manufactured. And talking about, no doubt, soon after independence, India did have a large population. But let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, majority population was practicing subsistence farming, all using primitive tools, doing farming on small patches of land. I ask, do you think that opting this very method of subsistence farming would actually prosper our economy? Mostly no, my dear friend. And no doubt, India is one of the most food producing nation now. But let me tell you, it is one of those among those nations which are most food insecure. If in case we would have emphasized more industrialization, we could have achieved the goal of being most developed and the most food producing nation as well, not one of the most food insecure nations. Back then, if we would have emphasized on more industrialization,
today food production would have increased. When our farmers were busy feeding their family, our country would have been busy feeding the whole nation. Thus, I would like to conclude that a fertile soil alone does not carry agriculture to its perfection. We require and we should have focus on industrialization. Thank you.
Very well said. It is said that without criticism, no administration and no country can succeed and no republic can survive. And that was an amazing round, but I am not able to see interjector number 5 on the screen.
Ma'am, actually, I'm having some network issues, that's why. I was disconnected by this.
Okay, so Beta, would you like to just portray your views regarding the answer that you have received from the participant?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I am satisfied with the answer. Thank you very much.
Right, thank you. So let's move ahead. So it shows that it is very important to have some healthy discussion. So I would first call the participant number 2 from team 5 for sharing the views against the motion. Do we have participant number 2 from team 5?
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am. Hope I'm visible.
Yes, you are absolutely clearly visible and audible as well. So your time starts now.
Greetings, respected chief guests, respected judges, teachers, and my dear fellow speakers. Today, I, participant 2 from team number 5, am here to speak against the motion. It's been 75 years of our independence, and we still hear people saying that Indian government should have focused more on industrialization than that focusing more on agrarian reforms. But to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, putting more emphasis and focusing on a foundation, agriculture was one of the best and the wisest decision Indian government could have taken at the time of 1947. During the 1947, a 70-80% people were itself indulged and employed in the field of agriculture. All the people employed in the agriculture field were illiterate. Even not having the basic knowledge of mechanical science, we were not technically equipped. And moreover, our economy was so low that we were considered as one of the poor countries. And then, we would have shifted our foundation from agriculture to that of the industries, our economy would most likely to fall. To tell you one thing, respected judges and my dear fellow participants, according to the Maslow's rule of hierarchy of needs, food is the first and the foremost thing a person needs to provide to itself. A person needs for the existence, a person needs to provide itself energy. But our country was not even self-reliant to feed its own people of 30.6 crore population. We used to import food that costed us around 200 crore rupees, and which was around 40.7 million tons. Then, even not having food, how do you expect our own countrymen, our own fellow people to work as labor in the industry? Do you want half of them to starve? To get the attention of my esteemed judges, I would like to say that it's the earning of a very own agriculture only that today we are able to invest in the technical field of India. To quote the success of a very own agriculture, I will give you the example of the buffer stock and the surplus food India has today. The buffer stock of India is so large that our country ensured that no matter what natural calamity we face, we are ready to face it. We are ready to provide the food to our very citizens. The best example is a COVID situation. When all factories and industries were shut down, the buffer stock, which was given by the agrarian reforms taken in the initial years, helped people, helped the government to feed the poor, give them the monthly ration. Going more statistically, let me tell you here that due
During the years of 1948 to 1951, our agriculture contributed around 56.5% to the India's total GDP and 49% to the India's total income, while agriculture just 17% and 15% respectively. So, for you to be productive, will you go from 0 to 100? No. Because you know that taking drastic steps will lead you to zero again. Similar was the case with our very own democracy in India. We took the baby steps to where we are today. At last, I would just like to say that agriculture is such an occupation which embraces the whole earth and feeds the whole earth and the population of earth. And putting more emphasis in the initial years was one of the best decisions. Thank you.
Round of applause. Thank you so much for your enlightening speech. I must say the roots of all goodness lie in the soil of appreciation. And appreciation can make a day, even change a life. Your willingness to put it all into words is all that is necessary. So let's call upon the Interjector 5 to come forward on the virtual platform to put the question to participant number 2 from Team 5. Are you ready?
Am I audible now?
Yes, you're audible, dear. You can put your question.
So it is a known fact that after India's independence, the industrial sector was in a very poor condition. It contributed only 11.8% to the national GDP, and the quality of good produced was subpar as the quality of good produced by the countries. This, along with stringent government control, gave little incentive for foreign investment in Indian industries. Due to this, India missed out the technical revolution that was happening in the rest of the world, which eventually led to fewer job opportunities for Indians. Well, don't you think that if India had invested its time and money on employment generation and industries, it would have helped India achieve the goal of self-reliance earlier?
Thank you so much, dear fellow interjector, to pose me such a question. It's a really great question, but I feel that if there's even research on that, we did not focus on the industries in our initial years, but that's a false statement. We focused majorly on agriculture, but it was to be reminded and to be kept in mind that industries were not left alone. Our country was even supporting the industries that were indulged in various factors. To give you an example, for agriculture, we need pesticides, insecticides, fertilizer, and whatnot. Where were we getting it from? Industries, which itself says that we were also focusing on the industries. Secondly, you talked about the employment. Our 70 to 80% population, I mentioned earlier also, was employed in the agriculture. And you say that industries would have given them a good employment. But at what guarantee? For the initial years, the industry cannot guarantee a worker to pay a good wage. But at that time, what people needed was a good wage to feed its own people. Third, you mentioned that government should have taken the incentives, but I would really like to ask you here that was putting up more industries was important than feeding the old population? Was it? As lamp, when eased the darkness, produces soon the black substance. Similarly, in the ancient times, it was said, what person eats daily is what is produced. But at that time, people even didn't have the food to eat. How do you accept the laborers to work in the as intensive laborers in the factories? At last, I would just like to quote one sentence by the father of Green Revolution, M.S. Swaminathan, where he said that if agriculture goes wrong, nothing will go right. And we followed his step. And we are today, we are because of the agriculture. The agrarian reforms are bringing out the success today. We get around 70,490 crore rupees from agriculture itself, which we are successfully investing in the technical field. At last, last, I would just like to conclude by saying that agriculture is the foundation of the manufactures and a material art of the nature, which is and will always have to be given the first and the foremost priority, because it is the thing which will help you, me, and all of us to survive in this world. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your answer, but I'm not fully satisfied with it. And for your questions, I would like to say that cross-questioning is not allowed. Thank you very much.
Well done, both of you. Both the participants have really performed a wonderful combat. So on this note, I would say, raise your words, not your voice. It is the rain that grows flowers, not the thunder. It is rightly said, discussion is an exchange of knowledge, and yes, we all are adding more and more to our knowledge. So let's welcome our next participant, participant number one from team six, for delivering the ideas for the motion. So participant number one from team six is ready.
Yes, I am ready. Is my voice audible?
You need to increase your volume. Beta, your volume is little low.
Ma'am, is it now audible?
Yes, beta, it is audible. I hope judges, is the participant audible to both the judges?
Yes, ma'am, clearly audible.
Yes, right. Ma'am, yes. Ma'am.
Okay, so participant number one from team six, you may start, and your time starts now.
In every rank, both great and small, it is industry that supports us all. Greetings to one and all present here. And today, I wish to speak for the motion of the debate topic that India should have focused on industries and employment rather than agrarian reforms. At first, I would like to draw our attention to the countries like USA, China, Japan, to whom we see as an evolved country. And indeed, they are. But how many of you have ever tried to figure out the reason behind it? Probably most of you must be knowing it already, that it's their evolutions and speculations they have made in their industries. And after independence, India knew that industries would make the forthcoming of the world. Then why India didn't invest in industries as it did in agriculture? Thinking of agriculture, it may seem you all very salient for the sustenance of a country. But my interrogation to you all, that can a country really sustain without industries? If your answer is yes, then I totally disagree with you. Because from those small seeds to those big tractors, harvesters, and machines we use in agriculture is excogitated in industries. And after independence, it was pretty much clear that the population of India will unquestionably expand. And we cannot feed this huge population of India with those old traditional methods of farming. If you all consider agriculture as the backbone of a country, then in my view, industries are the energy of a country. Not only this, industries not only feed this huge population of India, but it is also capable of providing jobs to this huge population. Yes, because as per FAO, 26% of India's population was engaged in industries, who gave 26% of the total GDP. On the other hand, a larger proportion of unemployment, that is seasonal and disguised unemployment, is seen in agriculture. Though 59% of Indian population was engaged in agriculture, but they gave only 23% of the total GDP. Now, you can imagine India's position it would have been now if India would have invested in industries after independence. And as our former Union Minister of Commerce, Suresh Prabhu, has said, change is opportunity. So let's bring this change. And respected jury members, for a minute, if I consider India continuing to invest in agriculture, do you know what the youth of India would say to one of his friends? Hey, I have my father's land, so I don't have to study. After all, people study to fill their summer. And I will have enough food from my farm to fill my stomach. I totally agree with what he says. But this isn't the type of India our ancestors dreamt of. Is it? Absolutely not. At last, I would like to rest my case saying a few lines of my own. Plenty of labor, scanty of gain. Plenty of labor, scanty of gain, with dark future depends on rain. Such agriculture is full of pain, as money, mind, merit, all in vain. Labor in your favor for a pay. Labor in your favor for a pay. This makes life easier every day. Industry has given us a golden ray for shaping our life in every way. Thank you and hope you like it.
Applause to you. You have quoted your thoughts and views in an excellent way. Great efforts. I must say, for good ideas and true innovation, you need human interaction and debate. My dear participants, quality questions create a quality life. Successful people ask better questions, and as a result, they get better answers. So now I request interjector number 6 to put across the question to participant number 1 of team 6. Are you ready?
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, you're audible, dear. You can ask your question.
Good morning, respected jury members, excellencies, principal ma'am, all the teachers and the debaters present here. The important thing is that we must be constantly moving forward. Yes, the progressive realization of a predetermined goal and our growth should never end. I would like to thank you all for giving me a chance to be part of this debate competition. Now, I would like to ask a straight question. So, here's my question. Already, India have equally focused on industries and employment. So, how can you say that it has focused on agrarian reforms only?
Dear, you're not audible.
I request the participant first to unmute and then answer.
Yes, ma'am. Is my voice audible now?
Yes.
So, thank you for your question, first of all. At first only, you increase the importance of industries by saying that change is very important for us. And when you're questioning to me that India has equally focused on industries and employment, then I must ask to you that why this debate topic has been kept there. The debate topic itself says that India should have focused on industries and employment rather than agriculture after independence, which simply states that after independence, India has focused on agriculture more than industries, which is true. Hope you got your answer.
Yes, I'm satisfied with your answer.
Is the participant audible to the judges?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am, yes.
Okay, so be ready and your time starts now.
Once when an American journalist asked Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, "What is our culture?" He replied, "Our culture is agriculture. Our past is agriculture, our present is agriculture, and our future is agriculture." Greetings to one and all present here. Today I wish to speak against the motion of the topic that after independence, India should have focused on industries and employment rather than focusing on agrarian reforms. Indian economy under the British rule was fundamentally agrarian. About 85% of our population was dependent directly or indirectly on agriculture. Under the colonial rule, farmers were forced to produce cash crops like indigo, tea, coffee. The production of food crop was at the edge. The result being, we turn into a bowl begging for food after independence. Thus, India's first five-year plan launched in 1951 was focused on agrarian reforms because that was the need of the hour, as India was losing its precious foreign reserves and food grain imports. However, the second five-year plan was focused on industrialization. B.R. Shenoy, a libertarian economist, warned that this plan was a recipe for trouble, and he was proved right when India faced an external payment crisis and stood at the verge of a mass famine in the 1960s. That is when geniuses like M.S. Swaminathan stepped in and introduced the legendary seeds of HYV seeds of wheat and rice. Therefore, India's food security is completely dependent upon agrarian reforms. In order to feed the ever-growing demands of an ever-growing population, our people back in the 1960s had the unique knowledge of the nature, the soil, the climate, not of how to run an iron article in an industry. Fabrizio Bresciani and R. Wells in 2007 concluded that when both the direct and indirect effects of agricultural growth are taken into account, Such growth is more poverty reducing than a growth in a non-agricultural sector, the industrial sector. During the COVID-19 crisis, nearly all economic activities had come to a complete standstill. That is when agriculture had risen to become a beacon of hope and had the promise of leading India's economic recovery. It was the only sector to have reported the positive growth of 3.4%. As per the IMF, India is expected to emerge as the fastest growing economy in the coming 2 years, thanks to agriculture. During the COVID invasion, the urban population exodus to the rural areas. Just imagine the situation when there was no alternative job option of agriculture available to those industrial workers who were thrown out of the so-called employment generating units. Swami Dayanand Saraswati has said, Vedon ki aur loto, the Atharva Ved narrated the significance of medicinal herbs in human life. During this crisis, the world is moving towards our culture because it provided the much needed immunity booster herbs when it was the need of the hour. Then my fellow friends are trying to bite the hand that fed them. I'm totally astonished to find it out. At last, I would rest my case by narrating few verses of my own. Hope you like it. Disturbance that everywhere is found, industry causes it all around. High in the air, on the ground, pollution is free, human is found. Factories may pay you but can't feed until you go and sow a seed that will supply you dire need for the happy life that you will lead, that you will lead. Thank you so much.
Outstanding performance. You spoke so well. Dear participant, one important key to success is self-confidence, and an important key to self-confidence is preparation. And I must say, if something comes with great preparation, it will definitely boost your self-confidence and your voice will reach to the hearts of your audience. Now I request interjector 6 to put across the question to participant number 2 of team 6. Is the interjector ready?
Yes, ma'am, I'm ready.
Okay, you can put forward your question now.
Yes, ma'am. Again, this is a straight question. What is the purpose of agrarian reform and what are the measures taken for it?
Thank you for the question. First of all, the agrarian reforms that are taken to be first was the agricultural reforms, the building of canal systems. For example, if I take the canal system of Indira Gandhi Canal in the Rajasthan area, which has increased the productivity. That are the type of agrarian reforms which are required in a country. And also, it has been the priority when we say roti, kapda, makan, roti has always been the first priority. And no one, literally no one can deny that. Thank you so much.
Dear friend, you tried best to answer me, but I'm not completely satisfied with your answer.
What's now?
The Industrial Revolution was another of those extraordinary jumps forward in the story of civilization. A very good afternoon to honorable jury, respected principal ma'am, teachers, special invitees, and my fellow debaters. Today I'm standing before you to speak for the topic, after independence, India should have focused on industries and employment rather than focusing on agrarian reforms. Industrial development is the core element of any country's economy. It creates employment, promotes research and development, leads to modernization, and ultimately makes the economy self-sufficient. India is a developing country today, and as sad as it may sound, we are still facing problems such as shortage of resources and unemployment. The primary reason being slow and uneven development of industries in India after its independence. After independence, more than 80% of India's population was dependent on agriculture. The country was in a very poor condition and we were lacking behind in many sectors, especially the industrial sector. At that time, the industrial contribution towards the GDP of India was just 11%. The major cause for all of this was that after independence, most of our time and capital went into promoting agriculture. The government spent years on agrarian reforms, which not only took a lot of time, money and effort, but also created major instability in the economic growth of our nation. Even the poverty rate was a whopping 55%. Even after so much investment in agriculture and agrarian reforms, the poverty rate of India has just gone down by 20%, with it being 55% in 1960 and just 35% in present time. This might seem like a huge number, but when compared to countries such as China, whose poverty rate has decreased from 88% from 1981 to just 0.7%. This number still looks very small. Industrialization is the key to alleviating poverty, improving literacy, and in improving the economic growth of any nation. Industrialization not only promises self-sufficiency, but also increases the export of a country to other nations. Believing the potential of agriculture to be limited, the Indian government needed to provide priority to industrialization in building a strong economy. The effects of slow industrial development in India reflects upon its GDP per capita when compared to countries such as China. In 1960, China's GDP per capita was just 9% more than that of India's. And in 2016, China's GDP per capita was 79% more than that of India's. This widening gap was due to greater increase in China's industrial productivity and capital per worker. China has developed so much as a nation because of rapid industrialization and more emphasis on sectors such as steel and electronics. A great example of how industrialization has helped India develop as a nation is the comparison of GDP per capita of India and Pakistan. After independence, India's GDP per capita was 1.5% lower than that of Pakistan. And as all of us observe now, India's GDP per capita is much higher than that of our neighboring country. This implies that if India would have focused on industries and employment rather than focusing on agriculture after independence, we would have been a much more successful nation. To conclude my argument, I would like to repeat the words of Alexander De Croo, Prime Minister of Belgium. I quote, "Every industrial revolution brings along a learning revolution." Unquote. Thank you, Jai Hind.
Thank you so much. This was such a wonderful performance, and I hope at the end you all will take a great baggage of knowledge with you, which will definitely help you all in your future endeavors. Now, I would like to invite interjected number 7 to put forward the question to participant number 1 of team 7. Is the interjector ready?
Yes, ma'am. I hope I'm audible and visible clearly.
Yes, absolutely. You're audible and clearly visible, so you can put forward your question.
Perfect, ma'am. Greetings, honored chief guest, esteemed judges, teachers, and my fellow competitors. Before I begin asking my question, I'd like to thank the panel for this opportunity that they have given me to interject the worthy debater. Allow me to share a quick snippet with all esteemed judges. In Nazi Germany, a law of propaganda used to be followed, which said, repeat a lie often enough and it becomes the truth. So my dear friend, reiterating the same thing would definitely create an illusion of truth, but it most certainly won't be true. You have been continually talking about how industrialization would have provided to our economy, but it is genuinely disheartening to see how you forgot the fact that it would take a lot from our country and our economy. My dear friend, this is the scenario of 1947 when our India gained independence and we were considered to be hopelessly poor. In fact, after the Indo-Pak War, our third prime minister went to the United States of America begging for food grains to provide to our citizens. And if we would have focused a little bit more on agrarian reforms, we wouldn't be facing such an embarrassment. In fact, if we would have focused a tad bit more on agrarian reforms, we wouldn't be living in a corrupt society where zamindars are ruling the agricultural sector. How do you even think that industrialization was a better option while you compare a country like India to a country like China, which was in a way better situation compared to ours? Thank you.
That was a very excellent question. As for the answer to that, I would like to say, my friend, that the primary reason that
The primary reason that the poverty rate was so high and also that we had to take food from other countries was not because we didn't focus more on agriculture and was not because we didn't focus much on agrarian reforms, but it was because of lack of technology that had to support our agriculture sector and our agrarian reforms. The technology was so low that the harvest would often be very bad and we would get much less output in the form of crops. Moreover, at that time, the industries were so less that we didn't even have proper source of tractors, fertilizers, pesticides, and other resources that are essential for the development of the agriculture sector. So even if we did have full focus on agriculture sector, we couldn't have ignored these facts that if industries would not have been focused upon, we would have very less support toward the agricultural sector. And moreover, we would have not got any support from any other sector as well, because at that time, the contribution towards other sectors was very low as compared to agriculture. So don't you think that in development in industries would actually help us in agriculture rather than reduce the focus of agriculture that our country has made? I hope my answer has satisfied your question. Thank you.
Thank you for your answer, but you completely forgot the first point that I mentioned, which was India was hopelessly poor and we had nothing to provide to industrialization. But anyways, you tried your best to clear my curiosity. Thank you.
The time starts now.
Agriculture is the Archimedean lever, though it doesn't move a world, but tends to fill it with plenty, moral health and happiness. Good morning, everyone present out here. Today, I stand before you to express my views against the motion. Before I begin with my speech, I would like to pose a fundamental question. Where would we be without food and with the industries leading to increase in pollution? Every morning, we wake up and begin our daily routine. The agriculture sector becomes an important part of our daily life. It is very interesting to me that no matter what you do entire of your day, without agriculture, you will be simply naked and hungry. A country that cannot feed itself cannot have self-pride. And after independence in the mid-60s, 20% of all the wheat produced in America came into India. At that time, we were actually an agriculturally basket case. And 20 years later, we have become an agricultural power. This is just because of Green Revolution. In 1947, when we got our freedom from Britishers, our economy was in turmoil. We actually needed reforms in all the three sectors of the economy, be it agriculture, industry, or the service sector. But as it has been observed from the histories of many developed countries like China, USA, that at the initial stages of development, primary sector has to be given more importance. And in India, the same trend was followed. And consequently, we adopted various agrarian reforms, like land reform was the main focus of the government in the first 5 years plan. During 60s and 70s, Green Revolution and Operation Flood was introduced that focused on the improvement of inputs, leading to the betterment of outputs. My dear opponents, we all are aware that agriculture comes under the purview of primary sector, and the other two sectors, that are the industrial sectors and the service sector, are actually dependent on the primary sector, as industry will process on the things provided by nature. Similarly, employment in service sector and industrial sector also depends on primary sector. So, the agricultural production is the driving force in order to boost the other two sectors. Also, if agriculture will prosper, then only people could take up activities in other two sectors. Friends, I reaffirm that agriculture is the fundamental source of any nation's prosperity. Although the contribution in the GDP has reduced to less than 20%, and the contribution of other sectors have increased at a faster rate, the fact that agricultural production has grown cannot be denied. The reforms in agriculture have made us self-sufficient and taken us from being a begging bowl for food after independence to a net exporter of agriculture and allied products. Future of agriculture was, is, and will be a very important question for the planner.
because still half of the population of our country serves this sector. I also agree on the fact that both agriculture and industry are considered to be the two basic pillars of a developing economy like India. Without development of agriculture, no country can exist. And without industrialization, no country can develop. Thus, both the sectors should be considered as they're complementary to each other rather than substitute. I would like to conclude my speech with a quote, agriculture today makes tomorrow possible. Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan. Thank you.
Very well quoted thoughts. Well done. A good speech is like a pencil. It has to have a point. And you are all putting forward your points perfectly. So without any further delay, I would like to invite interjector number 7 again to interject participant number 2 from team 7. Is the interjector ready?
I hope I'm clearly audible.
Yes, your hope is absolutely right. You are clearly audible and visible as well. So you can put
you,
forward ma'am. Your question to the participant number 2 from team 7.
All right, ma'am. G.B. Shaw once very famously said, and I quote, "Beware of false knowledge. It is more dangerous than ignorance." My dear friend tried proving a point here, conveniently forgetting the failures of agrarian reforms. The government's main focus was land reforms. My dear friend, in today's scenario, only 5% of India's farmers control 32% of farmland. But nevertheless, after independence, our country had hopes from the social, political, and economical aspect of it. Our economy relied on agriculture and agriculture itself. In fact, 75 to 80% of our employed citizens were dependent on agriculture. When this was the situation, we needed a change. We needed a new start. We needed to rip off the band-aid. A better support to agriculture would have been given by industries itself. And even if our economy was relied on agriculture, then my question is just genuinely simple to you. Why did our government impose low economic value on our farming outputs? Just why?
Thank you for the question. As you said, that we should have focused on industries rather than agrarian reforms. So my dear friend, I think you haven't gone through my speech properly. I clearly mentioned that the reforms in agriculture have made us self-sufficient and taken us from being a begging bowl for food after independence to a net exporter of agriculture and allied products. And after independence, our economy was an agrarian economy. Rather than knowing the fact that we should have focused on industries, it is not the solution. And because that time we have focused on agriculture because our population was rapidly increasing. Although the contribution in the GDP has reduced to less than 20% and the contribution of other sectors have increased at a faster rate, the fact that agricultural production has grown cannot be denied. Thank you. Hope it answers your question.
Thank you for your answer. You clearly didn't consider the outcome of industrialization in our current country, but you tried your best to clear your curiosity. Thank you so much.
As Stephen Gardner said, Industrial Revolution was one of those extraordinary jumps in the story of civilization. Germany, America, Russia, France, what do these all countries have in common? These countries went through Industrial Revolution and became the developed nations they are today. These countries are called superpowers in today's world due to their development in sectors like science, technology, and of course, the economic development. Today, I, Arya Sakhi of APS Lay, will be speaking for the motion. Before the colonial rule, India had successful industries in handicrafts, textiles, metals, etc. But everything changed during the British rule. They did not let the industries in India grow. They wanted India to just become the suppliers of raw materials and also the market for their finished goods. Let us see the economic state of India during independence. There was poor capital formation.
political influence of the Britishers. There was poverty, lack of literacy. The literacy levels were below 16%, and for women, even worse, it was below 7%. 85% of the population used to live in villages and derive their livelihood from agriculture. In my mind, I think these were the factors that guided the government to focus on agriculture instead of industries. However, in hindsight, I strongly feel had we taken the path of industrial progress, today India would have been ranked among the frontline nations in the world in terms of developed industrial base, technological advancements, booming economy, and of course, higher job opportunities and other perks and privileges that industrial progress has the potential to empower individuals and communities for economic, social and personal development. Well, industries provide more job opportunities and reduce unemployment. They provide more wages. They help in enhancing an industrial base. And also, of course, they help the country to become economically stable. Industrial revolution would have helped solve a lot of problems like poverty, unemployment, and economic stability and other disadvantages that we faced during independence. I feel that we have missed the bus by denying the chance for industrial development, thus not being a developed nation. My argument is further proven right when we opened the economy in 1990s and embraced globalization, which led to progress in all spheres of life, like any other progressive country. Today, our economy is said to be the most vibrant and growing every year at the rate only second to China. And it comes with benefits like high employment opportunities, better infrastructure, and also better medical facilities, and many advantages that we have been experiencing since the last 25 years since we embraced globalization. To my fellow speakers who say that agrarian route is the right path to take, I would like to point out one of the main beneficiaries of industrial revolution is in the agricultural sector in terms of better fertilizers, automated farming, recycling of water, and better markets. In the end, I would like to quote George Bernard Shaw, who said, "Progress is impossible without change, and the people who cannot change their minds cannot change anything." Thank you.
Very well expressed. The best part of competition is that if we discover what we are capable of and how much more we can actually do than we ever believed was possible. I think with this positive competitive spirit, all the participants have discovered their capabilities to do more and more. So now I would like to call upon Interjector 8 to put forward the question to the participant. Is the Interjector 8 ready?
Yes, ma'am.
So you can put forward your question.
I appreciate the way you presented your viewpoint, but I have a query. India got independence in the backdrop of Bengal famine, in which almost 3 million people died. And in 1960s also, the situation was worse and India was on the verge of mass famine. So the need of the hour was to bring in reforms to help improve our agriculture sector. So my question is, if we would have focused on industrial sector, then it could have cost many human lives. Do you think industrial growth is more important than human life?
Well, thank you for the wonderful question. As you said about the famines, first, I would like to say agriculture wasn't controlled by us. It was controlled by the Britishers before independence. Second, yes, I still believe in my point of view that industry would have helped a lot more than agriculture. As they provide wages, as I said in my speech, that it provides more wages. As wages, then it is indirectly connected to food. So my point is that, yes, industries would have helped a lot in employment. And famines are caused because they don't have money. Money, we can take money when we are employed. So that's what I have to say. Thank you.
You did not touch upon the last part of my question, so I am not at all satisfied with the answer. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, both the participants.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am here in front of you all against the motion. When India got independence, India relied on 90% of agriculture part and only 10% of small-scale industries. The main source of income of people were from agriculture only. India had to focus on giving suitable reforms to agriculture so that India could export agriculture products and enhance the economy. India at that time did not have agriculture infrastructure and skill. Therefore, only way to rise in economy was agriculture reforms. And over the period of years, India became successful in carrying out agriculture reforms, which gave the boost to Indian economy, and this leads to setting up of industries. Thus, agriculture-based economy gave rise to industries in India. Green Revolution is one of the major achievements of Indian agriculture reforms, which had a great impact on agriculture export to other countries in the world, thus giving sharp rise to economy. Hence, we can say that agriculture reforms provided suitable base for Indian economy, which led to investment in other fields. And agriculture plays an essential role in the process of economic development of less developed countries like India. Besides providing food to nation, agriculture releases labor, provides saving, contributes to market of industrial goods, and earns foreign exchange. Agriculture development is an integral part of overall economic development. In India, agriculture was the main source of national income and occupation at the time of independence. Since independence, India had made much progress in agriculture. Indian agriculture, which grew at the rate of about 1% per annum during 50 years before independence, has grown at the rate of about 2.6% per annum in the post-independence era. Livestock declined from 4.21% to 3.40%. And some advantages of agriculture are that farming creates opportunities to lift people out of poverty in developing nations. Over 60% of the world's working poor work in agriculture. Farming creates more jobs, beginning with farmers and continuing the farm equipment makers, food processing plants, transportation, infrastructure, and manufacturing. Agriculture plays a vital role in Indian economy. Over 70% of rural households depend on agriculture. Agriculture is an important sector of Indian economy, as it contributes about 17% of the total GDP and provides employment to over 60% of population. The major reforms in Indian agriculture after independence were abolishment of zamindari system. That means the right of own the land was given to the actual cultivators, which then led to increase in the production, and cooperative societies were formed, which provided quality seeds of fertilizers and farmers at the low price.
Thank you so much, participant number 2 from team A8. I appreciate your efforts. And now I request the interjector number 8 to put forward the question. So is the interjector number 8 ready?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Very well spoken, but I have a question for you. According to NCRB, 256,913 farmers have committed suicide in the period between 1995 to 2010. And it's very disheartening to say, but India's ranking in food security index is 71st, and in human hunger index, it's 94th, much behind the countries like Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Nepal. Irrigation area accounts for nearly 49% only. The remaining area is totally dependent on rain, which shows how slow the technological advancement has happened in the agriculture sector. So my question is, we focused so much on agriculture sector, but did not get any major benefits. Don't you think we could have utilized those resources into developing industries and providing employment to people?
Well, thank you for your question. But after independence, like I said, that India had 90% of agriculture and 10% of small scale industries. So if India would have focused on industries, India would not have been developed till now. So it was more important to focus on agriculture rather than industries.
Our approach to economic development must be modern, focused, and in tune with the global trend. A very warm morning to all the jury members, excellencies, principal ma'am, and all the teachers present over here. Today, I am going to speak for the motion. India has only focused on agrarian sector, but we should know that in order to develop a country, there are several other factors that will promote India towards a better nation. On 14 August 1947, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru had declared, "Long years ago, we made a trice with destiny, and now the time comes when we shall redeem our pledge. The achievement we celebrate today is but a step and opening of opportunities to the great triumph and achievements that await us." These were the basic foundations on which India embarked upon its path of development since gaining independence in 1947. What is DAR? The Development of Agrarian Reform. DAR leads the Comprehensive Agrarian Reform Program, CARP, through land tenure improvement, agrarian justice, and coordinated delivery to client beneficiaries. The 1935 Constitution addressed the issue, that is, a foreign excess of land should have 60% of Filipino ownership and an increase in sharecropping share for about 50% to 70%. But very little of these laws were followed in practice, and the Huck Rebellion was born. Common goals of 5 years plan are growth, modernization, self-sufficiency, and equity. The proportion of people depending on agriculture did not decline as expected. Post-independence, the issue of employment had different resonances during different plan periods. In the initial years of development, unemployment was not expected to emerge as the major problem. It was assumed that reasonable growth rate and labor intensives would prevent any increase in unemployment rate. These expectations continued from one five-year plan to another during 1950s and 1960s. The phenomenon of comparatively higher rate during last decade did not translate into similar reduction of unemployment. This could be due to unemployment of educated, particularly women. Highly population rate, in fact, has reduced worker population in urban areas. In the case of urban areas, Gujarat has the least rate, while Kerala's rate has reduced from 2011 to 2012. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Am I perfectly audible?
Is the interjector audible to the judges?
Yes, ma'am, he is.
Right. So, Beta, you can put forward your question.
So, quoting Hal Lord Pinter, "Ignorance is knowing the truth, seeing the truth, but believing in the lie." According to a statistical report submitted by the NSO in March 2021, the agricultural sector improved the employment opportunities by 4%, from 145.6 million in 2016 to 151.8 million in 2020. From this, we can also take another thing into instance, that is the employment opportunities in the industrial sector decreased by almost 41%, that is 1.4 million down to 0.88 million. Completely contradicting our topic that India should have focused more on employment opportunities. Now, the second point which you mentioned in your speech was that women are not being given more job opportunities, and because of industrialization, they would have been given more. But I would like to point out that almost 48% out of the 151.8 million job opportunities are being fulfilled by 48% of the women. That's it. So hear me out as a moderator, and clearly your site doesn't provide that much of a weightage after listening to this factoid according to NSA. So what are your views on this?
In the case of urban areas, Gujarat has the least rate, while Kerala's rate has fallen in 2011-12. India is probably the most competitive country in the world, and we need to focus on the employment and industrial sector. We should promote entrepreneurship. Thank you.
So, in between, just my point, in between your answer was stuck, so I don't know what you said. And second of all, I think what you just did was quoted some parts out of your speech, but you should have provided me some more facts or some other factoid so that I could be more convinced. But the case is I'm not at all convinced with your answer. I still stand by my point that India should have focused on agrarian reforms only. So thank you, you tried your best.
Yes, ma'am. I'm ready, ma'am.
Your time starts now.
Good morning, to respected jury members, honorable dignitaries, principal, teachers, and my dear friends. I am going to counter the points made by my dear friend just now. Friends, every industrial revolution brings along a learning revolution. My dear friends, it has been 75 years of our independence, but today, can we proudly stand and say that India leads in the world as far as industrial development and employment sector is concerned? Do you think so? Well, today, my dear friends, I'm going to present harsh realities, which we all have to accept it with a pinch of salt. Today, we claim that we are heading towards a global superpower. But my dear friends, in this scientific, modern, and technological era, we cannot be found lagging behind other countries as far as industrial development and employment sector is concerned. Industrial development, my dear friends, is the need of the hour. Agreed that agrarian reforms are important for any country, but at the same time, focus should be on industrial development and creating employment opportunities. India ranks third in the global industrial production as per the latest report. Friends, why not the first position? Do you think that we don't have the potential to get the number one position? Focus on industrial production will give the answer. Another aspect of the GDP, gross domestic product growth rate. India's GDP fell from 8% in 2017 to 4% in 2020 due to less focus on industrial production. Do you think we deserve this after 75 years of independence? Industrial development will create employment opportunities. India's unemployment rate is 8.5% and India ranks 86th in the unemployment index. Do you think that our freedom fighters who gave their lives to achieve freedom for our nation ever would have imagined to see India's position as far as industrial development is concerned? Now, you might say that India has a fast-growing, diverse economy with large-scale workforce. But the reality is, my dear friends, due to its population, India is also one of the poorest countries based on income and gross national product per capita. Do you think we deserve this? Now, my dear friends, I would like to highlight certain advantages of industrial revolution. It increases job opportunity, production level, and income. So, my dear friends, if we really want to be a global superpower, leaving behind US and China, we as a nation should come and stand together and make our country strong industrially, and we should achieve the state such as koi bhi berozgar na hoga. So, my dear friends, remember, together we can and we will make a difference. Let's prove to the world that India is nowhere behind anybody, and let it be any sector of it, industry
agriculture, employment. Jai Hind!
Before putting forward my question, I just have one doubt. The person who just speaking was speaking for against the motion, right?
Yes, against the motion.
He was speaking against.
Yeah, so you completely contradicted yourself during the speech. You just focused how industrialization should have happened. While what you should have focused on was that how, when we focused on agrarian reforms, it was better for our nation. You completely contradicted yourself. You spoke for the motion. So basically, what your team 9 has are two speakers for the motion. So I don't think if I ask you the question, you will be able to answer it. Because there was nobody for against the motion. So if the committee in charge could please, you know, clear my doubt, whether should I ask my question or not.
You can ask the question.
I think you should pose your question.
Okay, I'll just pose my question. So once again, stating Ann Landers, the naked truth is always better than a well-dressed lie. Taking in the pinch of salt that you offered in the beginning of your speech. According to NSO report 2021, the industrial sector contributes almost 26% of the total GVA of India, gross value added. While the agriculture and the allied sector all together just provide 19.2%. In 2002, both agricultural sector and the industrial sector were provided by almost equal funds. That is approximately 50,200 crore rupees. But now, that is 2021, the industrial sector is completely dominating the agricultural sector, providing as much as double the input provided by the agricultural sector. That is 2,30,000 crore rupees revenues provided by the industrial sector in 2021, while the agricultural sector just provided us with 1,29,000 crore rupees of income. So, you know, if we would have focused more on, you know, the industrialization, we could have achieved greater heights of GVA and GDP. And supporting your point, as you contradicted yourself completely in the speech, we would have achieved greater heights than the other two nations. Thank you. What are your views on, about the same?
Yeah, I agree that agriculture is very important, but actually industry is much more important than agriculture. Do you know the drawbacks of agriculture? The farmer has to take one complete year for the crops to grow. First, he'll have to take loans and debt from the zamindar or bank. Then he'll has to plow the field, then sow the seeds. And when there's excessive rain in the month, then also the crops will get soiled. And if there is no rain, then also the crops will get spoiled. And in this pressure, like paying the debts or loans of the zamindar or bank and feeding his family, the farmer commits a suicide. And in a study, it was found that on an average, daily 10 farmers commit suicide. And as we all know that the previous slogan of our country was Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan. But in this technological era, our slogan is Jai Jawan, Jai Vigyan. Thank you.
Yeah, so completely agreeing with you because you just supported my question, supported me, and thank you very much for proving my point. So that could have been the best you could have done. But next time, please read the topic carefully and please don't contradict yourself. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
And another thing, the factor that you stated that almost 10 suicides are committed every day was completely wrong. I don't know where you read it. So please verify that too. Thank you.
Sorry, it was not contradictory.
Thank you so much, both the participants, for expressing your views.
Nation's progress is a sum of individual industry, energy, and uprightness, whereas nation's decay is a sum of individual idleness, selfishness, and vice. A very spectacular afternoon, respected chairperson, honorable jury members, worthy opponents, and my dear audience. Today, I am here to express my views in favor of the motion, that after independence, India should focus on industries and employment rather than focusing on agri farms. Well, my friends, post-independence, India had witnessed a huge economic development in the past 10 years. And yet, we are lacking in the terms of establishment of industries and employment. Now, here the question arises, that our Indians are not capable enough to run and walk alone in the race of progress without the help of Britishers. Well, my answer to this question is a clear no, they are capable. And to prove my point, I would like to elucidate that the topmost companies in the world are headed by Indian leaders. You want examples? I got it. CEO of Google, Sundar Pichai. CEO of Microsoft, Satya Nadella. CEO of PepsiCo is Indra Nooyi, and many more, my friends. That is why I think that India has not need to become anything else. India should become India only. And why not, my friends? After all, this is the country which once upon a time known as the Golden Bird. I strongly feel, my friends, that there is no dearth of talent in the country. But the only thing which holds us back is the lack of focus on industries and employment. I would like to further prove my facts by bringing some facts and a kind of knowledge that India has industries, and industries contribute by 24.6% in India's GDP. Whereas industries, they don't even contribute. Well, I would like to bring one more comparison into current tension, that in 1987, India's economy and GDP was at equal level compared to China. But suddenly the table got turned. And in 2019, China got 4.78 times greater GDP than India. I would like to bring one more fact in your kind attention, that India has industries and industry contribute by 24.6%, whereas there is nobody to contribute in the place of industries. And if we see, my friend, that if this continues, our dream to become the superpower in the world will never see the light of day until and unless we focus on industries and employment. I would like to further detail the point of employment. If we see employment in the agriculture sector, it is either seasonal or non-secure. Whereas employment in the industrial sector is both secure and non-seasonal. According to a report by UKIBC, the future of our country will be the manufacturing sector, because everybody nowadays are into technology and industries. And I can prove it right now. Everybody just look around you. Have a look around you. Either you're surrounded by a smartphone or a laptop. And everybody's knows us, hey Google, hey Alexa, and hey Siri is. But many of you don't know, but it's Rabi, Kharif, and Zaydis. At last, I would like to say that in the ordinary business of life, industries can do anything which genius can do, and many things which genius cannot. If you have genius, industries will improve it, and if you have none, they will supply space. At last, I would like to conclude my argument with a jingle. It says, I think there should be more scientific innovation. I think there should be more industrialization. God says new la la la, it's future la la. And everybody thinking, and everybody thinking for it. Thanks, and have a nice day, my friend.
Your time starts now.
Agriculture is the occupation of man, and it embraces the whole earth. It is the foundation of all our industries. A very good afternoon to respected jury members, chairperson, and my joint conference. Today, I am here to speak against the motion that is, after independence, India should have focused on industries and employment rather than focusing on agrarian reforms. Before we jump into it, I consider it essential to know about the scenario of India at the time of independence. The Second World War was just ended in 1945, accompanied with the partition and our independence. That time was itself the turning point of our economic history. It is worthwhile mentioning here that around 85% of India's population was lying in the villages, and the only means for their survival was agriculture. Poverty had casted clouds of doubts on India's survival, and in this situation, my dear opponent, heavy industrialization was the matter of huge trouble. Because of the absence of innovative methods and technology, India was still dependent on the imports for agricultural produce. Drought, famine, stagnation, all these were the free gifts given by the Britishers. So, let me ask you a question, that how the government would have focused on industries and employment when India was not even sure to provide 3 times meal to all its citizens? Dear friends, Great is not the nation that appears fancy, but the nation which values its people over diplomacy. The Green Revolution, the White Revolution, Kisan credit card schemes, and Grameen banks, all these were the important agrarian reforms brought up. And as a result of all these initiatives and reforms, India is today the global agricultural powerhouse. We cannot ignore the fact that India is still the world's largest producer of milk, tea, spices, and pulses. Second largest producer of rice, wheat, cotton, sugarcane, fruits, and vegetables. I strongly believe that agriculture of India has been the major source of supply of raw materials to various important industries of our country. So, the question is, if we had not focused on agrarian reforms, how the establishment of industries and employment would have been imagined? It is rightly said that a farmer is a magician who produces money from the money. If the farmer is rich, then so is the nation. The agrarian reforms contributed to relieve the unemployment pressure and to increase the agricultural productivity of India. My dear opponents, for your kind information, let me tell you that agriculture has contributed a lot to the industrial development because it supplies industrial raw materials like cotton to the textile industries and sugarcane to the sugar mills. The most important contribution of agriculture is to provide the food supply to the increasing population of our country. And during the planning era, just because of agricultural development, India has become self-sufficient in food supply. Agriculture is an important sector of Indian economy as it contributes 17% to the total GDP and provides employment to more than 60% of India's population. In a nutshell, it can be said that India has stepped towards new dawn of development just by focusing on agrarian reform. I would like to conclude with my grandfather's words. He used to say that once in a lifetime you need a doctor, engineer, policeman, and a preacher. But every day, three times a day, you need to fill your stomach up is a farmer. Thank you and have a nice day.
Well said, but HYV seed was the reason behind the agrarian reforms, the great revolutions in agriculture set up new one.
Actually, I didn't get
the land reforms. They were introduced after independence, and the main economic objective of India after independence.
I am clearly not getting your question, actually. What you are trying to say is just going over my head.
I will request Interjector 10 to kindly repeat the question. Interjector 10 is requested to kindly repeat the question.
Okay, so the main reason behind the great reforms in agriculture sector was also HYV seeds. The reason behind the change in agricultural sector was HYV seed. We got that from the new policy resolution. So is it not important? Was industrial revolution not important? It helped in our agricultural sector. The HYV seed, it helped us.
Okay, I got you. Thank you for your question, first of all. Yes, you're saying that isn't the industries are important when they have offered us HYV seeds, right? So I would like to highlight here that if we hadn't developed our agricultural sector, then you wouldn't be able to focus on your industries actually. Like the HIV seeds are the result of mutations in the genes. And that too was possible just because we were able to produce a good quality of seed first of all, and then only the mutation can be done. I think you should search it a little bit more about the biotechnology here. It is the application of biotechnology actually, and that too requires agricultural development, I would say.
Winning is great, but if you are really going to do something in life, the secret is learning in how to lose. Nobody goes undefeated all the time. If you can pick up after a crushing defeat and go on to win again, you are going to be a champion someday.
We have champions who presented their talent in front of such a big audience, and I'm sure that we will acknowledge that. So here is the most awaited moment. So I start by announcing the runner-up of Northern Command Inter-APS English Debate Competition.
I know everyone's heart must be beating very fast. So here we announce the results.
The runner-up team is Team 6, Old Kent Prayagraj. Congratulations to Team 6, Old Kent Prayagraj.
After that, we will move ahead to find out the winners for today's Northern Command Inter-APS English Debate Competition. Very well deserved. So the winners for Northern Command Inter-APS English Debate Competition is Team 5 APS Udhampur. Heartiest congratulations to all the participants of Team 5 APS Udhampur.
Now I'll announce the best speaker in today's inter-command debate competition. And the best speaker is Swasti Yadav from Old Kent Prayagraj. Congratulations, Swasti Yadav.
Heartiest congratulations to all the winners. And now today we are moving on to the last winner, that is the best interjector. And the best interjector for today's event is Master Karthikeya Sangwan from APS Srinagar. Heartiest congratulations to Team APS Srinagar. So these were the results. Once again, I give my heartiest congratulations to all the winners. And those who have not won, I must say there are many more competitions. So keep up the spirit, pull your socks, build yourself for all the upcoming competitions. Now, this whole event would be incomplete if we will not have an address from our honorable chief guest of today's.
Hamari shaan hai, hamari shaan hai.